Hey everyone, my name is Daquan Johnson. I'm an MDPhD student at the University of Maryland School of Medicine. And since now I'm basically a full-time PhD student, I thought it would be fun to focus a little bit more on the PhD side and also bring in a few other viewpoints on the value of a PhD. So today I'm joined with one of my best friends, one of the smartest people that I know, Matthew Landon, and we'll be asking him, getting his opinion on how he decided to pursue a PhD and the decisions and processes that it takes to decide to pursue a PhD. But first, Matt, you want to introduce yourself and tell everyone how we met each other?
Sure. So, hi everyone. My name is Matthew Landon. I met Daquan during undergraduate, where we were both at the University of Maryland, Baltimore County, where we shared an apartment for all 4 years of our school. Currently, I'm a PhD student at the Georgia Institute of Technology studying computer science. I just finished the third year of my program with a recent focus on information security.
Awesome, awesome. So let's get started and go right into the weeds. Let's ask first, why did you decide to pursue a PhD? And I know for me, if you haven't seen my videos yet, I'll link it up above, but I kind of went over this question before in my MD versus MD PhD versus PhD video. But for those who haven't seen that yet, I can give a brief rundown of why I chose to add the PhD to my clinical degree as well. And that's typically just because I enjoyed the flexibility. I enjoyed the critical thinking aspects of it, the discovery process. I enjoyed asking my own questions. I enjoyed getting answers to those questions, being the only one in the world that know the answers to those questions. And most importantly for me, I enjoyed the ability to impact thousands of people that I may have never seen. And so for me, the PhD was that doorway into having a wider and more broad-reaching impact on the world, not just my one patient at a time. Matt, you want to share your decision-making pathway and what drew you to your PhD?
Sure. So it was a number of things that made me decide to pursue a PhD. So one was what attracted me to doing research was the ability to be creative and work on projects that are interesting to me and whose solution could have an impact on society. So in undergrad, when I spoke with my other computer science friends, I heard that some of them were content at being what they call a coding monkey. Which sounds like a weird term, but in computer science, it basically means a software developer who is really only implementing assignments that they're doing, so writing code for what other people decide to work on. This closed structure was not really appealing to me because it wouldn't give me the ability and the flexibility to work on very interesting problems and have that impact that Descartes spoke about. Also, a lot of my mentors and my friends really believed in me and encouraged me to think about that I would be successful and excel in the research field. So these are some of the reasons that why I decided to do a PhD degree.
Awesome, awesome. So with that in mind, going all the way back to when we were undergrads, you were thinking, putting yourself back in like our undergrad shoes, what advice would you give to those students, I guess even sometimes some students even younger, to help them understand whether or not a PhD is right for them.
Definitely, Deacon. It's a super important question. One of the biggest things I would say is start research early. Start trying working on research projects and getting a sense of whether or not you like that type of work. Because the earlier that you can answer the question, do I like research? The earlier you can start planning for a education path that fits your interest. Kind of in that same direction, I would advise them to try and get summer internships. And I would say that students should try to have at least one summer research experience by your undergrad sophomore summer. These internships are critical for two main points. One, it gives students the opportunity to work in a real-life research setting for an extended period of time, usually 10 to 12 weeks. Without the distraction of coursework, so they can really dive in and have a full experience of what research looks like. So, the last thing I would say for students that decide they want to pursue a PhD is to start building relationships with people who can write letters of recommendation for you early. So when you're applying to PhD programs, they're generally going to request, I would say usually, at least 3 letters of recommendation from professors and other mentors who know your capabilities and who can speak to your research abilities, so that the people who are looking at your application know that you're capable of being successful. So starting the conversation early can really help to build those relationships.
I think those are 3 really solid tips. I think just to kind of tack on to that, trying research as early as possible is super key. I will probably post a few resources down the bottom. I know that for high school students, it's a little bit more difficult, but for undergraduate students, they're a little bit more available for you. So I'll put a couple of examples down so you can find them. And if you need more help, just drop some comments in the comments below. I think one more thing also that you touched on that's really, really important that will probably never go away is having those relationships to have good letter writers and good references. It's not only starting the conversation early, but keeping that relationship fostered and alive, because these people generally who you're going to get really care about you and your career trajectory. And so they love hearing your updates about the new summer internships you're getting, the milestones that you reached, the awards you've gotten, the conferences you presented at. And so I think it's really important to make sure you foster those relationships and keep them pretty well alive, not just for the letters, but also you may get some great advice or some job opportunities in the future. So I guess the flip side of that coin is, if a person is doing these things to figure out research is for them, what do you find are the major reasons that people decide not to do a PhD?
That's an interesting question. So one reason that I can think of relates to career path. So it might be the case that someone target career path actually did not require a PhD degree. For example, in software development, these developers are generally not going to require having that degree. And actually, people who do have a PhD degree are going to be considered overqualified for the software developer position. I think in the medical field, a clinical doctor may be in the same category where the position doesn't require PhD.
Yeah, no, that's 100% true. Most clinical doctors don't have PhDs. We represent probably about 2-3% of the graduating class of clinical doctors. And like you said, that usually the PhD comes with diminishing returns. If you don't plan to have a very involved research career, it doesn't really make sense to have a PhD as a clinical doctor, especially since during your PhD training, you're giving up some years in terms of your, I guess, your financial independence in a sense, because each year you're working on your PhD, you're giving up a full years of being a physician's salary. So you'll come out a little bit more financially sound and stable if you actually went the MD route alone, even including the loans you take out.
Definitely. And though in addition to finance that Acorn mentioned, another reason that someone might decide not to pursue a PhD is if they have family or kid obligations. So a PhD degree is going to require you to commit a large percentage of your time to your studies, whether that's doing research for your thesis or complete coursework on top of that other research. So if you already have to spend many hours per week with kids or other family members, then you might not be in a position to be able to dedicate the necessary time to a PhD program that it requires. Mm-hmm. Finally, one reason that I've seen is that some people will get grads going a PhD degree and think it seems too hard or overwhelming. So what I realized after I completed 3 years in a PhD degree is that the perception can be misleading, because when you're not inside of that grad school atmosphere, you're generally only going to be seeing the polished version of research, where you're looking at these published papers and presented a variety of research posters at the really high prestige conferences. But the thing to note is that you don't really see the endless amount of hours that went into that final image, doing failed research projects, dealing with all the setbacks. So that unseen time is really can be misleading. And the last thing I would say, for me personally, I was a bit overwhelmed by people saying that when you do PhD, you become expert in that area. Because I thought to myself, wow, how can one person become the greatest expert in one area? It felt like this huge task. But actually, thinking about it now, this is really just a natural consequence of working on the same problem for years. So if you study this one area for years, you're going to naturally learn everything there is about it and then add new information to it. So it's not really a thing to be scared of, I realize.
100%. I think those are some really key points. And every person's path, you're right, is completely different. Obligations, while there are some people who are able to do it with family and do it with the kids, not everyone can. And I think for a fact that graduate school for sure is challenging, but it's not impossible. So if you enjoy the topics, you enjoy learning, you enjoy adding new value, you enjoy discovery, I think it's definitely something that people should consider. Even if it seems challenging, again, it's worth nothing worth having comes for free or comes easy. So you have to work really hard, but it'll definitely be worth it in the end. So first, I want to thank Matt just for his time and dropping some really valuable gems and walking us through why he decided to become a PhD student and eventually Dr. Landon. And just the insight, I think it was really valuable and hopefully it was going to help some other student, help an undergraduate student or a high school student decide whether or not they want to go that path. And hopefully we can do some more collabs and have him talk more about PhD life. I know that he said that he's open to talk about more topics like going through a graduate program with a disability or other topics that may normally discourage students from pursuing a PhD, but how he's actually thriving and doing really well where he is. So post any questions in the comments below for a future Q&A. And as always, like, comment, subscribe, and see you in the